Pierdomenico is a professor in plant physiology at the Scuola Sant'Anna in Pisa, of which he was in the past also the director. And he will talk to us about innovation through DNA and RNA technologies. Thank you, Pierdomenico.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm glad to be here. And as soon as my slides will be on, I will try to be fast because I realize that we are already late. The good news is that I tend to speak fast. The bad news is that I have a lot of slides. So let's see which will be the final result. Okay, so I'll skip the first one because this is just the title. And I will move to the obvious. We already know all this. The world population, I'm trying to get this working, but... I'm trying to have the pointer. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So the world population is increasing, and we are heading towards very worrying numbers in terms of world population. And you see, around 10 billion people in 2100. Okay, we will not be here probably, but it will be a problem for those who will be here. This will lead to the need of more food. There is no doubt about this. There are a number of estimates online, so I don't know how reliable are all these estimates, but some of these say that we need 70% increase in food production, which is very worrying because it's a lot, okay? So we need for sure to change something in the way we produce food. And the other important point is that we know that all this is happening in the context of climate change. So not only the world population is increasing and we will need more food, but we will need to produce this food in a context which will be more difficult than in the past. We will have less water in some places, more water in other places, higher temperatures. So we will need to change a lot in the way we do agriculture and we produce food. So we will need to choose among different scenarios. We have to do something, of course. We cannot stand and see, but we need to choose among different scenarios. And I found an interesting publication which came out very recently, which is the result of a European project, which presents four different scenarios. One is the plant innovation scenario. The second one is the your food health choice, the food emergency, and the reject tech. We will see rapidly now which each of these scenarios propose. The first one is financial means, growth, and technological options unlimited. So what we can use all the available technologies, we have unlimited the financial resources to reach the goals, the scientific goals, the innovation goals, to produce new technologies, to innovate at the fastest possible speed. The second scenario is what Giovanni Carada described us, is the consumer-driven market. And when I say consumer-driven market, I do not only mean something which is of interest of the supermarkets, because the consumer will decide what they will sell, but the consumer decision inevitably influences the policymakers, and the policymakers will influence science in the end, and therefore will impact in the direction that research will take. Then we have a food emergency scenario, which is something that to me reminded the COVID emergency. Okay, so we had a health emergency, we have a pandemic situation worldwide, and science was allowed to go faster because we needed vaccines, we need therapies, we need monoclonal antibodies, we needed RNA-based vaccines, which were never used before, and all this happened very fast. So that scenario demonstrates that it is possible to face a specific emergency, drought, as an example, by applying an emergency scenario in which we provide unlimited resources, but which are focused to solve an emergency. I don't consider this good because unless the emergency is a real emergency, something which cannot be predicted. I just showed you that we can predict that the population will increase, that the climate will change. So it's not really a scenario which we can apply to what we know. And then we have something that again was described by Giovanni, which is the reject tech scenario. So there is a general mistrust in science, policymakers, and the agri-food system, and we want agriculture to get back to the past. We don't want innovation, we don't want anything which is new, and we want to keep things not as they are, but even to go back to the past. So technology is bad. So we have to reshape agriculture, but based on ecosystems needs, et cetera, et cetera. So not using technology. So the big difference in these four scenarios is this. So the fact that all the technologies that involve DNA modification are not desired or not accepted by many of these scenarios, okay? So what makes the real difference between these scenarios is whether we will be able to use or we will be hampered to use technologies that influence DNA. And this leads to the first part of my talk, which is DNA technologies. So which technologies are available to modify DNA so that we can produce more, better food, or using a sentence which is very popular, to produce food in a more sustainable way. So, and this leads to a new genome techniques as they are defined, which are exactly the TEA technologies described by Giovanni. So the new technologies of DNA manipulation. I'm very worried when I use these words because DNA manipulation is not fantastic. Okay, but I know this is the way it is used generally. And in order to identify what they are, I show you this. These two covers of Science and Nature. They date back some years, and they presented the technology of CRISPR-Cas9 as the breakthrough of a year. So we are not, when we talk about something new in science, we do not necessarily talk about something that happened yesterday. It might be a technology, a science advancement that happened 5, 6, 10 years ago, but that is now ready, the technology is ready to be used in agriculture to produce new food. So, but if we have new genome technologies, there should be all genome technologies, okay? It is nonsense to say that we have something new if we don't have anything old. So let's see what they are, the old genome technologies. But, well, this was already said by many of you, also in the questions. So breeding, human beings have been improving crops since millennia. And this was done by modifying genomes, because if you cross two species, what you will end up is a mixed genome of the two parents. So it's a big, this has breeding has a huge impact on the genome, which is an impact which is even stronger than transgenesis. So if we speak about which is the impact, the actual modification on a genome by simply talking about breeding, breeding inevitably has the biggest impact, because it's two genomes, possibly of two relatively unrelated species, but which were compatible or made compatible by the breeder, that are mixed together. Then we have mutations. Plants have been improved by mutations since centuries. And one way to mutate a genome is to use radiations, which will impact on DNA at random. It will modify at random the genome, will lead to hundreds of negative effects and possibly to a few positive effects. And in this slide, you will see the radiation field, which was in near Rome at Vienna, where a source of radiation was in the middle of a field, and all the crops grown around were irradiated to increase variability, to speed up evolution in a way, in a very strong way, okay? Harsh way. And this this approach led to many crops which are actually used and consumed. One example is the pink grapefruit, which is which was obtained by mutating the genome by using radiations. And it's quite nice to see that this ruby grapefruit obtained by radiations is sold as a jam, which is organic. So we have a paradox here, in which we have two scenarios together. On one side, we have your food health choice, which is, for example, buying organic, and on the other side, radiations used to produce the crop that was used to produce this jam. So it's an example of how these scenarios might be in conflict, and the consumer might not always realize about this conflict. So, and then there is transgenesis, of course, so GMOs. GMOs are perceived as a kind of failure, okay, especially in Italy, okay? Well, GMOs, we don't have them. We survive, we had no problems. We forget that we import GMOs from Brazil, from other countries, and they are not really 0 kilometers crops if we import them from Brazil. And this is the surface of hectares, which is currently grown with GMOs. And well, saying around 200 million hectares does not tell you much, okay? How big is this surface, okay? Well, let's compare it to the surface of Italy. So this is the whole surface of Italy, which is around 30 hectares, million hectares, of course. So the surface which is cultivated with GMOs is huge, okay? And we are talking about corn, soybean, and cotton, no more. So GMOs were a great success, a technology which had a great success, and a success which Italy did not take any advantage of, because we are paying the costs of this technology by having to import from other countries the GMOs we are not allowed to cultivate. And this is the scenario, okay? So here I put together a number of claims that are used to convince the consumer that that product is better, okay? Because it's GMO-free, because it's non-GMO, a natural product, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So this leads to the new genome techniques. So with this part, I hope I convinced you that human beings have modified genomes since ever. So we are not talking about now these crazy scientists are starting to modify the genomes with something new. It's simply that the technology is going ahead. So, and we are talking about gene editing, and which is the characteristics we wish for gene editing, to be safe, precise, and predictable. Because not even breeding is inherently safe, precise, and predictable. We cross the plants, and we hope that the new plant will be better, will be safer, and showing the traits we want, okay? The reality is that we cross fingers as well, because we hope to get the desired result. And the same is with GMOs. It is not true that you are doing genetic engineering because you have a project and then you realize the project is based on try and errors, the transgenesis process. So we need something better, okay? So what is genome editing and what is CRISPR? Because the technology which uses genome editing is called CRISPR. So it's something that was discovered by Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna, which were working on a bacteria, a useless bacteria. We were studying an apparently useless process, biological process, in an apparently useless bacteria. And they discovered by chance a mechanism that is happening in that bacteria, but that can be translated into a very powerful technology. And for this discovery, they got the Nobel Prize a couple of years ago. So the technology is based on this protein, which is Cas9. I will not go into the detail, but you can recognize here a double helix of DNA and a blue single helix of RNA. So this is how the system works. This protein will cut DNA and will be directed to a precise position by the RNA sequence. So we can use RNA as a sequence which will find the complementarity in DNA and will then act at that specific position. And this will allow what is a site-specific, in a way we can say mutagenesis or editing of DNA. Well, CRISPR means this, I don't even try to read it, okay? So it's forget it, okay? You know that it means something, but you will never be able to remember better. CRISPR means clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats. I think that this is not very friendly in terms of communication, okay? Cas9 is easier, it is a CRISPR-associated protein number 9, okay? So just because acronyms are puzzling, I wanted to show you that there is something behind the name, but it's something that you can forget. You know that it happens. How does it work? Well, Cas9 is a molecular scissor, so it cuts DNA, but it does not cut DNA in any places. It cuts DNA exactly in a position. It cuts DNA, of course, and it cuts DNA following an RNA guide sequence. So you get a site-specific DNA cut. And this site-specific DNA cut is followed by a repair of DNA, which might modify DNA in that specific position. So you will get variants. You may get a knockout if you choose the right position. So you switch off the gene, or you can modify the gene. You can get the gene to be more similar to a wild relative, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And this is how it works, very simply. Cas9 is this light blue molecule. It opens DNA, which is the orange double helix. It utilizes the purple RNA guide. You can design it in the lab. And this RNA guide is used to define the exact position where DNA will be cut and then repaired. So it's simple and efficient, okay? In my lab, we started using it and it worked the first time we tried. It did work, it is faster, more efficient than transgenesis. Great. So this technology can be used to modify plants and to modify plants in specific traits, because now we know, thanks to the genome projects, we know the genome, exact sequence of the genome of many crops. So we can identify the genes which are responsible of the specific trait, which is still difficult. It's not an easy job. And we can modify them for getting better food and better agriculture. The very first CRISPR, which is not a plant, which is a fungi, which was produced is this mushroom, which resists to browning. And immediately it led to this. So, and this allows us to say that, yes, we are using a new genome technology, but the perception is simply that is a new generation of GMOs. And of course, with all the easy terminology that can be used by Greenpeace and all these organizations which are against, which are for the reject tech scenario, okay? Because this is exactly the reject tech scenario. So we have a new technology, but if we adopt the scenario number four, which is reject tech, it will stay in the labs and will never reach the supermarkets. And it will never reach the developing countries. It will never reach any place where it can be used to solve food-related problems. Now, many companies predicted that we could have CRISPR plants in our dinner plates in 5 years. Usually, it's always better not to make predictions because usually you fail, okay? But in this case, it was not too bad. So we should have had the first CRISPR dinner in 2020. But we now have the first CRISPR modified crop, which is on the market in Japan. So there is at least one CRISPR based product in Japan. And this is interesting because Japan was one of the countries which was against GMOs. People in Japan didn't like GMOs, and there were no GMOs in Japan apart from some blue colored flowers which were initially produced in Japan. And the second point which is of interest is that this is improved in nutritional value because it's enriched in GABA, which is supposed to lower your blood pressure. Okay, so it's a nutraceutical product which is aimed, if you consume it, to make your health, to improve your health. Without taking pills, you eat tomatoes. This is the oversimplified scenario. And this is more recent, well, 14 February, it's very recent, is a wheat which produces less acrylamide. You will say, why should wheat produce acrylamide? Well, all food produces, contains good things, but it might contain also bad things. Okay, so we eat it and we usually bad things are here and well, good things are here and bad things are here, so but are still there. So we want to reduce the amount of acrylamide which can be produced by wheat. And this was obtained by genome editing, demonstrating that we can use this technology to produce better food. Of course, we will need also more food and of course, plants more resilient, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But this is feasible. So the European Commission is discussing how to regulate these new technologies. We have two scenarios on the table, the plant innovation scenario or the reject tech. Who will win? We will see, okay? Politics will decide actually, and then the consumers will be important in this decision. And this will set the direction that Europe is taking for the use of this technology. Europe, remember that Europe is not the world, okay? There is China, there is the US, there is South America, there is Africa. So there are other continents that might take different decisions than Europe, and we will see. So the point is that CRISPR-Cas9 leads to permanent genome modifications, which are different from transgenesis. We are not talking about inserting foreign genes inside the genome, but they are permanent genome modifications. And this might be one of the reasons why we have a very reject tech perceptions. Okay, it was said there is also something religious. So God created that DNA. Why, how you they're modifying it? So the permanent genome modification is perceived as possibly dangerous, scientists playing God, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So let's go to RNA technologies. so which are something newer and which are different from DNA technologies, although CRISPR-Cas9 in a way is partially an RNA technology because it utilizes RNA as a guide to cut DNA. So let's remember that RNA is the first product of gene expression, which will lead then to a protein and finally to a phenotype, okay? So if we are talking about RNA technologies, it means that we are going to modify the way RNA is present in the cell. So we are not touching DNA, we are playing with this molecule. So the DNA, the genome is untouched, but we can act downstream. So why should we modify the genome if we can modify the expression of a genome and more specifically the expression of a specific gene? And in this case, we can get a transient modulation of gene expression. Will still this be rejected by people who reject technology? So we do not modify the genome. We modify the way the genome is expressed, okay? And the genome, the way the genome is modified in its expression happens every day. If we have sun, the genome is expressed in one way. If it rains, the genome is expressed in another way. So we are simply exploiting the ability of a genome to adapt to something. And we can do it because there is one process which is very important, which is the RNI process, which means RNA interference. Again, scientists are not very good in finding terms, okay? Because if I tell buy these new tomatoes produced by RNA interference, it doesn't sound so, it is not friendly, okay? The word interference, at least. But the concept is that you can have the a sequence of small RNA. The small RNA can enter the cell and will recognize a sequence of RNA and will destroy it, you know, to make it simple, okay? So you can use small RNA sequences to destroy messenger RNA. So to destroy the messenger in, so you will block the expression of that gene, or you will strongly reduce the expression of that gene. And this can be done, to kill insects, for example. If you have a plant which contains this small RNA, which encodes a gene, or better, encodes a sequence for an RNA in the insect, which is an housekeeping RNA, so producing a protein which is essential for the life of the insect, then you will kill the insect, okay? Because the RNA will downregulate the expression of one gene, which is essential for survival. And of course, you can design RNA for that specific insect. So only if that specific insect having that specific sequence of RNA is targeted, then it will be the only one to be killed. Bees will not be affected. For example, you want to kill a bug, you design an RNA which will kill that bug because it will recognize a sequence of RNA which is specific of that bug, but completely absent in bees. So you can treat and the insect will eat that sequence, and simply by eating, it works. So the insect eats this small RNA sequence and it is killed because inside the cells, the process of RNA interference will block the RNA, an RNA which is essential for life, okay? And you can do it by spraying. So you simply spray the plant with this double-stranded RNA, it will be uptaken by the leaf. And depending on the sequence of RNA you utilize, you can kill some insects, fungal pathogens, viruses. It has been demonstrated that you can block viruses because you can target RNAs which are viruses. Many viruses in plants are RNA-based, chewing insects, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the RNA technologies which are most promising are based on double-stranded RNA foliar spray. So it's not, we are no more talking about modifying plants. We are not in the seed industry producing a new variety of plants obtained by gene editing or by transgenesis or by breeding, but we are talking about something which will be exploited by companies usually selling fertilizers, pesticides, because it's an RNA-based pesticide in this case. But we can, and it has been demonstrated that this happens in a trans-kingdom way. So the RNAs of a plant can interfere with the fungal RNA, but also the fungal RNA can interfere with the plant RNA. So you can interfere with this mechanism in a way that the plant wins the battle with a pathogen. And even more recently, my lab demonstrated that this is also possible in nature. So if you have a plant which is overexpressing one specific small RNA, it will be released in the soil and it will be uptaken by a nearby wild type plant, and you will modify the way the genes are expressed in the target plant by simply growing it nearby a plant which is producing that specific microRNA. Or you can simply add a synthetic microRNA, which is identical to the natural one, to the soil, and you will modify the expression of a gene in the receiving plant. And given that microRNAs are important for a number of traits which are important in agriculture, from stress, biotic and abiotic stress, development, et cetera, you can utilize an RNA spray to modify plant development, to modify plant resistance to stresses, to modify plant resistance to insects. So RNA spray for transient modulation of gene expression is a new technology that might be more perceived as more friendly. RNA is non-toxic, of course. We eat RNA every day. We will have RNA for lunch. I'm pretty sure we will have also DNA for lunch. This is something that I can predict. And we eat normally, so it is not supposed to be dangerous for health. And it will be transient. It will be like any other agrochemical product which is sprayed on plants, but it will be more specific. And it will act on specific insects, specific traits, and it will be able, once developed, to improve the plant productivity and food production. In a way, there is not one single technology that will save the world. We will need an array of technologies, and many of were mentioned, okay? We need precision agriculture, we need artificial intelligence, we need DNA and RNA technologies, we need better pesticides, we need better farm management technologies, et cetera, et cetera. But if we use all these technologies, we will be able to save the world, and the human beings will be still here in a heavily populated world, but possibly living living well and healthy, and possibly more than 100 years in good health. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Pierdomenico, for the very interesting talk. We have time for a couple of questions online.
Okay, thank you for the great talk. I have a question concerning the CRISP mechanism. So when, say you want to change the color of that mushroom, so that it doesn't get brown, if I remember correctly, and you know that you can associate this property with a specific site that you target with RNA. But I mean, once you cut, I have two questions. The first one is, can you also manipulate the way it's reformed in that specific place? And the second one is, how do you know that the specific site doesn't correlate also with other properties that you didn't want to change?
Yeah, okay, so answering to the last question, you need to know very well the process, okay? So the genes involved, of course, the gene involved encodes for an enzyme which will oxidize one compound which will become brown. And so you want to kill that gene, and you do it by the knockout approach of CRISPR. So one approach of CRISPR is simply you target the gene to make a version of a gene which is no more functioning, okay? It's the easiest way of using CRISPR to get the knockout of gene. But you can also do what you proposed. So you can repair the DNA by either hoping that it will be a new sequence will be in the repair process, the sequence will be slightly changed in a way that the protein is more efficient. So in that case, we will have a mushroom that get more brown. Okay, it's undesired, but just to explain what happens. Or you can use a guide to, you can even use the technique to insert a new trait, a new piece of DNA. But in that case, the technique is used to make a GMO, okay? So I'm not talking about that. The problem of GMOs, one problem of GMOs is that you cannot predict the site of insertion of the transgene, the foreign gene you are inserting the genome. By using CRISPR, you can insert the foreign gene in a precise site. But in that case, it's a GMO, okay? So it's not the new genome technology I'm talking about. The new genome technology I'm talking about is a technology that does not leave anything in the plant that is or can be called as transgenic. And this has an impact on the regulatory aspect. While you can trace any transgenic plant very easily, with this technology, you will not be able to trace it. Okay, so if a country, think that the country of your preference, will start producing seeds modified with this technology, and will start selling the seeds to us, and no one explains how they were obtained, there is no way we can discover it, and we will use them. Okay, so. And you know that to enforce any law, you need a method to detect the people that are not respecting the law. And in the case of CRISPR-Cas9, it's reasonably easy to hide the modification. It could have been happened by chance in nature as in a laboratory by using CRISPR. And this has a big impact in terms of the market, okay? Because a country which is not regulating this process carefully can very easily have varieties that are superior. While we are discussing about should we do it, how do we regulate it, we might start receiving this plant. There is a nice story about an orange petunia which was on sale in Italy for a while. It was transgenic, it was just by chance entered by error. And people were very happy because usually petunias are not orange. And they were buying them. And then someone discovered that were a transgenic plant that were not illegally, it was by error probably imported in Italy. So if you don't have a method to detect the modification, it's very easy to alter the market.
Okay, thanks. Like everything is very clear. I just have one remaining curiosity, which is, once you use CRISPR, let's say in the easiest way that you said, so you just remove that, you deactivate or remove that gene. I mean, I'm not an expert in genetics, but one gene is coding for more than one property, I guess, right?
Well, I'm not a geneticist. So one gene is encoding. The dogma is one gene, one protein. We know that this is not true, okay? There is one gene. And there are there is the possibility that gene produces different variants of that protein, okay? But usually, one gene encodes for one trait.
Okay?
Or together with other genes.
Okay, no, I just want to rephrase it like in the most naive and simplest way possible, my question. So isn't there the risk that once you change the color of the mushroom without being knowledgeable about that, you're also changing other properties that you don't didn't want to change and you make it poisonous. Okay, this is ridiculous,
it is possible. It's the same when you cross two plant species. You cross two plant species and you mix two genomes, okay? You don't know how the interaction of the two genomes together will be expressed into a new plant. Okay, so you might, and there are examples of breeding leading to toxic, for example, to a high accumulation of alkaloids in some plants. So it is not, the risk is is inherent in any technology. Okay, but it's not the new technologies which are also the old technologies are even more dangerous. Right. What you need to do, of course, is to evaluate carefully the final result you get. Something which is not done with breeding. Okay, so my lab produced a tomato which is black. Okay, it is on the market. No one asked us to prove that it is not toxic. As far as I know, nobody died till now. Okay.
Okay.
But this is the only toxicological result I can discuss with you. So no one claimed that a relative died after eating our black tomato. So it's nonsense that on one side you have to spend 2 million euros to prove to carry out toxicological tests on GMOs or any modified plants. And on the other side, you can cross anything, obtain anything weird. Okay, because a black tomato is weird. Okay. And that's the reason why we are selling it. It's weird. People like it. But in theory, you should check. Okay. It's the same.
We don't have time, sorry, but we are very short. No way. Otherwise, we cannot have lunch. Choose between question and lunch, because we have to be here at 2 sharp, because the speaker at 2 has to start at 2. So sorry about that.
Anyway, I will be here all day. So just in case you need to ask questions.
Sorry to have to interrupt, but we are very late. So our last presentation of the morning is from a speaker who will be connected online. He's Leo Violini, who